You're listening to the Cheap Geek Podcast. Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/CheapGeek. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. So it begins again. This is Cheap Geek Podcast, episode number 46.
A picture's worth $1 million, Interstellar, and Big Head Alien Boy.
So welcome back to the Cheap Geek Podcast, and this is the podcast where we talk about things we find on the internet to be interesting.
Yeah.
So anyway, so our last podcast, we gave away some stuff and we contacted all the winners so far. By contacting them, we just did a podcast hoping that they would contact us. And surprise, they did.
Yes.
So, there's a couple things going on with the Cheap Geek Podcast, and we're kind of branching out in some of the new directions there.
Yeah.
Trying out this whole Anchor thing. Trying to see how that works. So you'll be able to follow us on Anchor. Now, Anchor has a tendency to let you do about 5-minute clips, which is kind of tough for us because we talk so long that it's way longer than 5 minutes.
That's true.
So, but anyway, if you'd like to listen to an abbreviated version of the podcast on Anchor in about 5 to 10 minute segments, you can certainly do that. If you go to Anchor and download the app, or go to, is it Anchor?
Yeah.
Anchor.fm. Anchor.fm, and you do a search for Cheap Geek, you can find us there. Yeah. And Anchor has some pretty neat features. You can actually call in during the middle of the podcast and leave a message and things like that. So it's
kind of applause.
Yeah, you can make the little clapping sound, which to me is really annoying. So if you'd like to clap a lot, you could do that. Yeah. It's very nice. But anyway, this podcast, we have a couple different things to talk about, a couple interesting things to talk about. And one of them is this wedding photographer won $1 million.
Yeah, that's kind of crazy.
Now, they didn't win the lottery or anything like that. They actually won it from a defamation suit. Against the couple. And I read this multiple times, and, you know, see, here's the thing. Everybody talks about First Amendment, right? Right to free speech and all that good stuff, and how it's free, and, you know, you should be able to express yourself and all that. Well, guess what? Everything has consequences, and this couple has found out that there are consequences to the tune of $1.8 million. I'm sorry, I misread that. $1.08 million. Might as well be $1 billion in my book, because I couldn't afford that. So, did you read this?
No, actually, I was trying to figure this out. I saw the headline, but I didn't get a chance to look
at it.
Well,
it kind of goes like this.
Yeah.
All right. So, there's a wedding photographer named Andrea Pulido.
Mm-hmm.
She's been awarded $1.8 million by a jury in her defamation lawsuit against a couple who launched a public campaign against Pulido for her $150 album cover charge. All right. So, when you read that, you're like, what? You know, it kind of gets a little bit deeper than that.
Okay.
So, in January 2015, a news station, NBC5 in Dallas, Texas, they aired an investigative report into this couple who basically, you know, they have accusation against Pulido saying that, hey, you know, they said that the photographer demanded an extra $150 for an album cover after the couple had already spent $6,000 for the wedding photography.
Okay.
Right. This couple is named the Moldovans?
Yeah, Moldovans. That sounds like a movie character, yeah. Movie villains.
You know, and they were saying that they expected the album cover to come with a free with a free cover, right?
Yeah.
So, and then they said that Pulido was refusing to provide a CD of their photos until the album was paid for.
Oh.
So they make it out like she's holding their photos hostage.
Oh, I remember this.
Yeah. And it kind of, it goes through, and there's going to be a link in the show notes. Of course, you can kind of follow along and watch the video. But pretty much what happens is, there is the couple, the Moldovans, got on the social media sphere, intersphere, the web sphere, whatever, and basically painted her out to be a terrible person, right? Which caused huge online backlash against the photographer.
Yeah.
And basically, you know, she got on there and she published a letter, an open letter, explaining her side of the story, but by then it was really too late. Yeah. She kind of explained that she'd offered a couple of free album cover
before any mentions
of a news interview or anything like that. But the couple went ahead and decided to go ahead and do a smear campaign against Polito and her business publicly.
And here's the thing. They did the smear campaign, I can tell, for their own benefit and their
Absolutely.
Own exposure. Because it says, we, as in the photographer, have taken action to make things right. And instead, this bride went directly to the media, bragging about the upcoming news story on all of her social media accounts and creating a very large following, which was boosted by her business as a professional social media expert.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So she jumped in there and was going to blow it out, right?
Yeah.
And there was comments that she made, statements. Like, I'm pretty sure her business is ruined.
Yeah.
I hope this goes viral. Feeling excited and justice has been served.
Yeah.
And these aren't the actions of a concerned and hurt bride. And that's what the photographer's saying. She's like, okay, they basically went through and they did this.
If this story was truly based on how upset and hurt the bride was, she wouldn't post statements to humiliate me personally or harm my my business.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so she pretty much instigated a lynch mob of negativity. So.
Yeah.
Okay. So what the photographer did was filed a $1 million defamation lawsuit against the couple.
Yeah.
Right? And she basically claimed defamation, business disparagement, tortious interference with prospective contracts, and civil conspiracy. If you've ever been involved with any moron on the internet who thinks that since they weigh 1,000 pounds on the internet, right, and they're out there, it becomes a thing.
Yeah.
We're talking, this goes beyond trolls. This goes to, attacking, basically destroying somebody's life over the internet, right?
Yeah.
So, a jury awarded Polito, the photographer, $1.08 million, finding that the couple wrongfully attacked Polito and that their public campaign against the photographer was false and malicious.
Especially because that photographer, I guess she has statements proving that she offered to make it right.
In the contract.
Yeah.
It even shows that you have to pick one of four album covers and that there's a cost associated.
Yeah.
And so basically when she tried to reach out to him and say, okay, just pick the album cover, it's too late. These people went on their own agenda. And they went out there and trying to use First Amendment and everything else and try to further themselves, to make them, to get that sort of viral notoriety there. They kind of burned themselves.
Oh, so she's already an established photographer. And if you know anything about the wedding business, it's a tough gig.
Yeah.
You can't just go buy any camera and start calling yourself a photographer and expect to make a lot of money.
Yeah, because she was making like six figures.
Yeah, this lady, six-figure income from shooting photos alone. And that's not including like taking on students or doing photo seminars. Her photo business was destroyed in a matter of days.
Yeah. Completely took her down to nothing.
Yeah.
So, and she didn't do any photography for like 2 years, right?
Yeah.
So they were, the jury came back over $1 million including punitive damages, right?
Yeah.
Because they were defamed, or she was defamed by these two terrible, shameful people. And that's what their attorney said. That's what the photographer's attorney said.
Yeah.
He's like, as I told the jury, freedom of speech is not freedom from consequence. There are real world consequences for maliciously attacking a business online with venom and lies. I'm all about expressing yourself, but I kind of look at this too. There are consequences, and if you're going to do something like this, and it was obviously nefarious the way it was with a couple out there trying to further their social media presence, then you deserve to get burned with the heat of 1,000 suns.
True.
It's just crap.
I feel bad.
So, oh, and this was on Petapixel, by the way, which is like a photography-related type, website. Yeah.
I feel really bad for the photographer. I do see, though, that she is a savvy businesswoman.
Yeah.
Immediately after the suit, she says that she plans to rebuild her business but shift it towards helping other photographers grow their independent businesses.
Yep.
She's also created a new nonprofit, probably for that $1.8 million she's got now. The nonprofit foundation is called SAS, Survival After Social Shaming, to help people who have had their reputations torn down by online mobs.
Crazy.
That's really good, though. I'm going to check that out.
That's something to check, you kind of think about. So there you go. If you're listening to us on Anchor, thank you very much. And you can listen to the full podcast on iTunes, Instagram, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, Google Play Music. You can go and join our CheapGeek Facebook group.
Yeah.
You can find us all over the place. So, there you go.
Oh.
Now, if you're listening to the Full Link podcast, you're like, what am I doing? And we're just talking about Anchor, as we talked about before. So, there you go. Yeah, so I thought that was kind of interesting to see that, somebody was actually being taken to task for doing this, because so many people on the internet get out there, and like I said, they weigh 1,000 pounds behind a keyboard, and they think they could do things with no ramifications. And hopefully, I really hope this couple is shocked by...
I wonder if they're going to pay out, though.
Oh, they're going to have to. I mean, even if they have some kind of insurance or whatever, even though you know they can appeal, they're not going to get away consequence-free, as well they should. Because honestly, too many people go out there and they think that there really is no consequence on the internet, and we've got the whole cyberbullying and everything else that goes on.
Yeah.
You know, hey man, the internet is now real. It's not like it used to be. If you buy an island off eBay, the people that sold the island are certainly going to be awaiting payment. And if you do dumb shit on the internet like that and you get popped for it, well, you kind of deserve it.
Yeah.
So that's the way I look at it. So, but I thought that was kind of interesting. It's like, what? And somebody actually sent me that. And I don't remember who it was. I think it was one of my subscribers on YouTube's. Pretty sure it was Prospero27.
Oh.
So if you're listening and you were the one that sent me that link, I do appreciate it. And then, anyway, if you have any comments, questions, concerns, and you'd like to get a hold of us, you can certainly do that. We do appreciate feedback. If you have anything that you'd like us to talk about, we can certainly do that too. But before we do all that stuff, and before you start typing and sending us all these wonderful messages, we're going to talk about our next article.
Yes.
Which I thought was super cool and really interesting. You want to know what it is?
Sure.
You tell me what it is, because I can't find it.
Researchers just launched a prototype of humanity's first interstellar spacecraft.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes.
I forgot about this.
And I am looking. The very first image on this article is a bunch of arrows pointing at a tiny little computer chip.
Well, it's a good thing I'm here to explain, right? Okay, so I found
this
on Gizmodo.
Mansplain this for me.
First off, you make it sound wrong and inappropriate, and it's not. Okay, so when it comes to interstellar spacecraft, we have a couple, right?
Yeah.
Now, what makes these, and I don't want to go into great and agonizing detail because I'm not a big space guy. I'm not a sports guy either. I'm not a sports ball guy or anything like that. But there's this really small spacecraft that's being made.
Yeah.
It's like maybe 1.5 by 1.5 square. It's got solar cells. It's got a little microcontroller on it. Has a radio. Has an antenna, of course, that can receive transmission and send transmission. Has a magnometer, which is basically like a magnet meter.
Yeah.
And a gyroscope.
And that's it?
That's it.
Huh.
It's really, really small. And basically what goes down is this. There's an extraterrestrial exploration venture.
Yeah.
You call it Breakthrough Initiatives. And they basically want to send tons of tiny spacecraft to our nearest neighboring star system, Alpha Centauri.
Ah, and their first project is called Breakthrough Starshot.
Yeah.
The little tiny spacecrafts, oh, that's so cute. They're called sprites.
Yeah, little nanocraft.
Yes.
And pretty much, since they're so small and they launch these things can go whizzing through space at like super quick speeds.
Hmm.
Yeah. So they've already successfully sent 6 of these little test crafts into our low Earth orbit. And they're about 3.5 centimeters on each side, so square, 3.5 centimeters square. So, hey, if you're not American and you know what 3.5 centimeters is, that'd be great if you want to let us know. Because I don't know the measurements, man. I'm not about all that stuff. But they weigh about 4 grams, right? And the aerospace engineer, Zach Manchester, he designed them. He's been working on them for like 10 years.
1.3 inches around.
Okay, so that was about right. So an inch and a half.
Yeah.
So the question is, you know, that they had was how small can they make these satellites and still make them do something useful.
Huh. Okay.
So, you know, space is a serious business, so it takes a lot to get things out into space. You know, how do you get enough power? How do you give them power that they can harvest? How do you communicate back to Earth? All this stuff that they had to figure out took them about 10 years to figure out for these little tiny little sprites.
Okay.
So these little mini spacecraft, right?
Yeah.
I think they're going to call them starships. We'll be able to travel at 20% the speed of light, which is about 37,000 miles per second.
That's
and it would take a spacecraft. Yeah, it would take a spacecraft traveling at speed less than 7 seconds to reach the moon. And that's from the Earth.
That's really good.
Yeah, so they can get these things really whizzing out there. So those are speeds and distances that no spacecraft of any size have gone before, right?
Yeah.
And so currently the farthest craft ever built is NASA's Voyager 1. Which they launched in 1977 when I was 7. And it just reached interstellar space about a year ago.
Oh.
Yeah. And if you are paying attention to our history, in the first Star Trek movie, V'ger was the Voyager 1.
Okay.
Remember V'ger? You don't remember that?
No.
What?
I don't know. Nope. Sorry.
Okay. So anyway, for now, those little sprites, man, are chilling in low Earth orbit. They were launched in June. And so, yeah. Anyway, if they get this done right, they can launch thousands of these things.
But then, aren't we just sprinkling space with space trash?
Yeah, hell yeah. We're just throwing our trash out in the interstellar cosmos, man.
So instead
these
of...
These little, you know, 1.5-inch square circuit board things is whipping through space.
So in, like, 50 years, like, the new generation of left-leaning people will say, like, instead of global warming, solar warming or something. I don't know. Like, solar system warning.
Like, yeah, pick up your trash.
Yeah.
So I just think it's cool that they have actually gone a different way.
Yeah.
You're going to use these itty-bitty little space brights to kind of get out there and record information. They don't have to be very complicated. They're going to have a set of parameters that they're going to use, and they're going to basically send the information back. But I do like the idea that they're going to be using, you know, something like this to kind of get more information. And yeah. The fact that these things can whip around 37,000 miles per second, I thought was super cool.
Yeah.
So there you go. So anyway, I thought that was kind of cool. And well, like one of the comments was like, go, little spacecraft, go! Like, heck yeah, man. So, there you go.
Okay.
Very nice.
Yeah.
All right, so I think we're going to take a second and take us a little commercial.
Okay.
A little break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about some other stuff, including there's a Sasquatch picture that might be authentic.
Really?
Yeah.
Ooh.
I like how they put that in quotes. They're like, it might be authentic. Also, two Pennsylvania women have a Bigfoot encounter. And we're also going to talk about the Outback Steakhouse conspiracy.
Ooh.
So, oh, yeah, there you go. What do you think about that?
That's cool.
Yeah.
Audible is an audio entertainment that entertains, educates, and inspires. For you, the listeners of the Cheap Geek Podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. The Cheap Geek Podcast recommends Midnight Crossroad, a novel of Midnight, Texas by Charlene Harris. We also recommend Welcome to Night Vale, a novel by Jeffrey Craner and Joseph Fink. To download your free audiobook today, go to audibletrial.com/cheapgeek. Again, that's audibletrial.com/cheapgeek for your free audiobook.
And we're back. So, there we go. Here, check us out. So, this article, right?
Yeah.
This article comes from Cryptozoology News.
I kind of feel like we pick on them.
We do.
Yeah.
I don't know why exactly. I just... well, yeah, I do. Anyway.
Yeah.
So, pretty much what it is, you have a BFRO investigator.
What is
you know,
it?
You know what BRFO stands for?
Bigfoot Research...
something. It's like
Operation.
Yeah, they're known for the Finding Bigfoot TV show.
Okay.
So they're at a Colorado convention last month, and they released a photograph of a bipedal creature in Washington State.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
And so the picture was provided by, or provided to Matt Moneymaker.
Yeah.
From somebody, and it shows a large primate in the middle of a thick green vegetation type area.
Oh.
Yeah. And so Moneymaker believes that the picture could be authentic, and that it, and basically attendants of the convention claim that they've seen something similar to it like that before, so they're thinking, hey, this might be an authentic picture.
No.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, and people were like, you know, it's not clear why there isn't a video of the purported encounter, but there's like a video, but there's the picture.
Okay.
It's kind of a neat looking picture. And of course, it went out to the Twitter space. And basically, Matt Moneymaker has the little caption underneath that says, anyone seen this photo before? I received it from a fourth hand source. It might be authentic. I want to find out.
Hmm.
And then basically left an email address and it's a contact email address to contact us at bfro.net. But if that's a real picture, that's, I don't know, that's kind of interesting.
It looks too much to me like...
No, I don't go there. See, because here's what you're going to say. It looks too good.
Yeah.
Well, that's because we're used to all the shit that people show, right? So we actually have what looks to be a good picture, and we're like, what? That's too clear.
Yeah.
That looks too good to be an authentic picture.
It does.
Where's the trash that we're looking for?
Honestly, yeah.
Well, yeah. But see, here's the thing, though. There's a lot of motion blur in the image, and it is slightly blurry. And the fact that, you know, hey, the Bigfoot thing or whatever it is looks to be standing still and is darker than everything else with contrast. It looks like whatever is there, I mean, it doesn't look like it was photoshopped in.
Yeah.
It looks like whatever is there is actually there.
That's true.
Now, if that's authentic or not, I don't know. Yeah. But, I mean, it doesn't look like it's been like an edited picture. It looks like that's a legitimate picture. If it's a dude standing in a suit and they posed and took a picture.
Or, in my opinion, a suit just standing there. Like, somehow, or a mannequin or something. It's too still compared to the rest of the image.
Well, I don't know, because if it's a screen grab and you have motion, yeah. Because see, it doesn't look like motion blur caused by a subject. It looks like camera blur or camera shake.
Camera shake and too much bad light.
Like, well, yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. As far as pictures go, it's a bad picture. You know, but it doesn't look like it's not an authentic picture. It doesn't look like it was added to it, because there is a little bit of blur down at the bottom of the legs. The edges aren't exactly clear. If whatever is standing there, you know, then that looks to be an authentic picture. And it doesn't look like necessarily that it was photoshopped in, because even a bad picture, there are spots that typically will be in maybe better looking in the image than the rest of the image. And I can totally see doing this. I can see grabbing this picture before the camera has a chance to completely autofocus. You know, or something like that.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, we'll post a link and you can basically check the show notes and see.
I cannot stand his Twitter account.
I'm not a Matt Moneymaker fan. Kind of think he's a la douchebag, but that's just me.
Somebody,
I'm entitled to my opinion.
Somebody commented on this photo on Twitter to him. Was that picture taken in 2001 with a flip phone? And he's like, oh, because you would have gotten a so much better photo in that brief, unexpected moment, right, troller? So I'm like,
well, I mean, he's, yeah. You know what? Good on him for fighting back.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, honestly, you can take a picture with an iPhone or something even today. If the camera hasn't had a chance to focus, this is the kind of results you get.
But
we actually have a picture that looks decent enough where it doesn't necessarily look like it was filmed with a potato. It actually kind of reminds me more of an action camera.
Unless it's a famous person tweeting to him. He has some pretty
harsh, terrible things to say to people.
He's
a douchebag.
Other people who tweet him evidence of other things, he gets automatically dismissive. Like, someone else sent some video to him, and he's like, that's obviously a bobcat.
Yeah, that's right. Crap. You know, and there's a comment that's actually on the Cryptozoology News website, right? Yeah. It says, it's badly photoshopped. If you have a photographic and artistic background and extensive experience with actually using Photoshop, you can tell easily.
Yeah.
This guy's a dumbass, first off, because you can't. This is first, its right hand is the only thing in the photo that's even close to being in focus. Zoom in 1,000% and it's obvious. Okay. Nothing else on that focal plane is in focus. It's fake. I won't even go into inconsistencies in the pixels themselves surrounding the figure. It's fake and badly done at that. You know, that person, even if they did blow up to 1,000 times or not, you're basically taking a photo that's been sent, compressed, and edited through Instagram for display Instagram for display on the internet. So if you blew it up 1,000%, there's no way you'd see anything.
Yeah.
As far as detail. So that person's comments are crap. And I'm not defending the picture. I'm just saying that, I mean, it could be an authentic picture.
Yeah. If we had the original.
Yeah, you need the original with the original file, you know, all that, because you have a lot more weight to the file itself. So when you go through and zoom things in and look for color shading and pixel density and gaps of information there, you can certainly find it. But when you take something that's been dropped all the way down to, like, anyway.
Yeah.
Internet resolution is not photo resolution.
I mean, even me, I was trying to salvage some photos because I changed phones, and I was trying to salvage them from Facebook.
Yeah.
When I download them to Facebook,
they just fall apart.
Terrible. Terrible.
It's like
compression.
You know, hey, go try to print a thumbnail, everybody, and then when you have a terrible result, you're like, well, something's wrong with my printer. Oh my god. And then you call, right, and go, hey, there's something wrong with my photo. He said, well, what's the resolution on it? And they said, well, it's 160 by 160 or 320 by 240 or something. And I'm like, well, congratulations for printing a thumbnail. Yeah. Where is your 20 megabyte file with a 1920 by 1080 resolution or even higher? You know, or 1600 by 1200, which equals 4x6. It's like, oh, wow, you know, yeah.
Yeah.
Technology, man. Kind of know a little bit about this stuff. And that picture, I mean, you know, hey. And here's the thing, too. The person that mentioned the little Photoshop comment didn't mention anti-aliasing or aliasing in general or artifacting or anything else. And the fact that it's pretty much uniform all the way through, and the only thing that's different in that image is the Bigfoot. It makes sense. Because, you know, there's all sorts of autofocus. You have phase detection, you have contrast detection, you have a hybrid, which is like...
And then
anyway,
if the
I'm not going to talk about all that
in
great agonizing detail.
It makes those decisions on its own.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And what's your metering mode? Are you partial? You know, are you center weighted? Are you using evaluative where it evaluates everything? I mean, there's a bunch of different things that's involved in this. And who's to say this is actually a picture from an actual point and shoot camera? This could easily be a still from a video camera.
Oh. At which point some of that...
Like, for my little video cameras, I can grab a still at 1920 by 1080, and it could look very similar to this.
Then some of that blur in that photo makes more sense to me if that's the case.
Exactly. That's why I was looking at it going, you know what? To me, this doesn't look like necessarily a point-and-shoot type thing. It looks like a still or a frame grab off of video.
Yeah.
Because that's what it looks like to me. And that's just my slightly more educated guess than the average bear. But... There you go. I thought that was kind of interesting, and it kind of ties into this next one here. I'm like, well, okay, that might be authentic. And then you got these two Pennsylvania women. they had a serious encounter with Bigfoot.
Yeah.
It's like, what? It's on the same site, Cryptozoology News. You can kind of check it out. This is in Cambridge Springs, PA, which is Pennsylvania, in case you were wondering.
Crawford County.
Yes, right. And this lady says they seen not one, but two Bigfoots. Would it be Bigfoot or Bigfeet? Or Bigfoots.
Bigfooty.
You know, like Facebook is like Facebooks, maybe, if it's plural.
Yeah.
You know?
Maybe
iTunes, Facebooks.
Maybe you just add an
Googles.
I at the end, like you do in Latin, to make it scientific.
Or, I don't know, that might just make it silly. So Deborah S. of Cambridge Springs told Cryptozoology News, it's been a while since she saw the creature, and she tried telling people from the area, but they ridiculed her.
Well, yeah. I mean... It's
She's like, I just don't say much anymore.
Pencil talkie.
Yeah, so. I was ridiculed.
Yeah.
My friend Angie saw one the other day, or the next day.
Oh.
So it makes me wonder, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so she was dropping her brother off at Mark Burns' place when she came across the alleged cryptid.
Yeah.
She said, as I came up to the dirt road, I was waiting on a truck to pass so I could pull out. I saw something I thought was a bear wobbling back and forth by a telephone pole and a road sign.
That sounds like a drunk person.
Could be, but you know, if they're kind of ducking around back and forth, it would... You know, the obvious weird movement might make it more interesting to pay attention to, which is probably what happened here.
Yeah.
The hominid, she said, was about 9 feet tall and had brown hair. The woman says it stared at her for a few seconds before she decided to drive away.
Huh. Right? Yeah.
It stepped out from the ditch, took 3 steps across the road. It looked right at me. I was scared and took off with everything that truck had. It's a good thing she's not, you know, a Mustang driver leaving the driving coffee thing, because she would have stepped on the gas pedal and took out like all the pedestrians.
Well, the following morning, she asked one of her friends to go investigate the area with her.
Yeah.
They found some prints. Those were 14 inches long and about 6 inches wide, and there were 5 toes. Now, this is a 9-foot creature with a 14-inch foot. That kind of sounds a little small to me. 5 toes, but no claw nails like a bear, just straight toes. She had also seen a scratch on the pole where it kind of pushed off to get up on the road. There was also a path with more prints on the other side. We went up Hecker, driving at 5 miles per hour, and I was looking left and Angie was looking right. She turned towards me to say something and asked me to pull over. That's when she claims they found one of the creatures on top of a tree.
Up in a tree.
Oh, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. A small, light-colored one.
Looked to be eating apples, and it had something in its hands like a grapevine.
Okay.
And the dogs were barking, and it looked to be watching in that direction, so they took off.
I wouldn't have taken off. It sounds like you got dogs in the vicinity. There's 2 humans. You have a vehicle. I wouldn't have taken off.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, it's okay. But think about it like this. We kind of do social media.
Yeah.
So we look for taking pictures of different stuff. So we'd be kind of like, oh, let's grab a couple pictures of this. Probably to the point where if this thing decided to get us, it probably would.
I mean, yeah.
So, but, you know, if you're sort of geared towards looking for something to take pictures of and you're kind of in that mindset, you'd probably more likely be, you know, ready for it.
Yeah.
But if you're just a regular person or two chicks hanging out in the car and they spot it, they probably did the right thing. They're taking off, man. They got to go.
I would have taken pictures. I mean, they have a vehicle. Roll up the windows. Drive really fast.
Yeah. That'll save you.
Yeah.
You can't get in, man. I got the window up. So Bigfoot's like, let me in. Like, no, man. Window's up. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. But they said they lived on the road as a kid. And, you know, this is the person, right?
Yeah.
She told her brother about it. And he said, he told him that they saw many prints and that their mom saw a monkey once.
Mm-hmm.
And she explained, she was like, thank you for not thinking I'm freaking crazy. But see, last month there was a man from northern Pennsylvania who claimed that an ape-like humanoids were able to camouflage like chameleons and are living in the higher parts of the nearby pine trees. We kind of read about this.
Isn't that the Jersey Devil, though?
No, that was the one they were saying that eating aliens or something like that. Aliens were eating the troops and they're chameleoned in trees.
Oh.
Yeah.
Like Predator?
Something like that.
No, so. This woman is telling the story,
excuse me,
you know, about this happening where she lives in Cambridge Springs. It only has a population of 3,000. I believe my graduating class was like 2,000, so.
Yeah, something like that.
I mean, so this is a small town.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if... I don't know. I still feel that I would have tried to take some pictures or called the police, something.
Yeah, so. I don't know. I mean, there's so many instances out there where people could have done stuff like that, and they never do.
Yeah.
And then when they do, we critique them for it. So, I mean, who knows? Maybe they weren't expecting to see anything at all. Maybe they have crap phones. Who knows?
Okay.
You know, some people aren't, you know, wired, I guess, the same way we are. Because I don't like leaving a house without some kind of camera, whether it's on the phone or an actual camera itself or whatever, but... I don't know. I think she was just trying to find a little bit of validation to one of her friends.
Yeah.
So, do I have any reason to disbelieve what they're saying? Not really. I mean, I think that they may have thought they've seen something. And they said they found some prints or something like that. And I would like to see that. You know, if they found tracks, why didn't they take pictures of the tracks?
Yeah.
I can see being so freaked out that you just don't think to take pictures of the animal itself, whatever it is. But the tracks where you are, I mean, take pictures, not, you know.
And you know what?
It's
nothing. We are guilty of that. I mean, we had a non-paranormal sighting. We keep talking about when we were driving through New Mexico, and there was an elk right next to the van. And we
I could have totally filmed that.
Yeah.
I didn't film it at all, talking to this elk thing.
So
there we go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
what do you think about that?
I don't know.
Yeah, who knows? So I thought it was kind of interesting. Now, this is something that you thought was pretty interesting.
Yes.
You should talk about it real quick whilst you have the chance.
Oh, okay.
Not that we're running out of time or anything like that. It's just something like, what?
So this started off on Twitter. It made its way to Instagram, and now it's hitting mainstream media. It's a conspiracy theory, which I love. However, this one's got some quirks about it. And that is, Outback Steakhouse is at the center of a bizarre conspiracy theory. Now, if you've seen this article, you already know a little bit about it. A Twitter user by the name of Eat My Aesthetics posted a very deep dive and research into Outback Steakhouse. And that's the fact that in major metropolitan areas, all of the Outback Steakhouses seem to form a pentagram across the city. That's
interesting.
Pretty scary. Now, it's really, I don't know, it's weird because like New York, Indianapolis, Georgia, a bunch of other major cities, Outback has a pentagram across the lay of the land. It's just weird. What is going on? You wouldn't think that Outback Steakhouse, you know, Bloomin' Onion and really big steaks would be connected to, I don't know, some sort of satanic symbolism or Wiccan symbolism.
Yeah.
Yeah, the pentagram, we all know, it's actually associated with Wiccan traditions and witchcraft traditions, but it usually gets misguided or thrown into conspiracies about Satanism. But could you imagine Outback Steakhouse is being run by a bunch of Satanists?
Well, I don't know. They actually responded in this whole Twitter thing, right?
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And one of the things that Outback Steakhouse responded with is, if the Bloomin' Onion is evil, then we don't want to be nice. And this guy, Sky, is like, for real, let me get a $25 gift card or $25 worth of that black bread.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And Outback Steakhouse, like, send us a direct message and we'll hook you up. For real.
Really?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Or is it?
Oh.
Maybe they're like, we need to take you out. So.
But,
so it kind of keeps going. Yeah. And then, like, Strawberry Sarah's like, I'll take one, please. And, you know, B-17 Bomber, yeah, me too. And everybody's jumping in there, but no other response.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, one of my favorites is you've got this lady is basically salting her windows. Mm-hmm. Or actually, it's, I think, who is that? Is that Dean or what's his face from Supernatural?
I don't see. Oh.
Yeah.
You're looking on the Twitter feed.
I'm looking down the Twitter feed itself, so. It might be coincidental, or it could be that they need to position themselves in the middle of the Midwest so that they could basically take over.
Well, other people are actually, you know, noticing it, and they're looking up the cities they live in, and they're also finding pentagrams. But
interesting.
The whole story reminded me of something that I read years ago, and that was, where did I read that from? I think I found it on io9, and it was that there's a conspiracy about Washington, D.C., and that's that the streets of Washington, D.C. are supposed to form an inverted pentagram. Now, if you look at even the earliest maps of Washington, D.C., you can clearly see pentagram designs. It's been attributed to, like, Masons, Freemasonry, the original designers of Washington, D.C., which were Pierre L'Enfant and Andrew Ellicott. They were supposedly Freemasons. You do a little research, though, you find out that Pierre actually only went through a couple of stages of becoming a Freemason. So,
quitter.
Yes. Well, the weird thing is, if you really blow up the street map of Washington, D.C., you see a lot of inverted pentagrams, and you see some incomplete pentagrams. So there's some quitting there, but it's also kind of spooky.
There's, like, pentagrams or Outback Steakhouse pentagrams in lots of different places. I'm going through and taking a look.
Yeah.
So, interesting.
But that's what this whole thing reminded me of, was the fact that Washington, D.C., of course, is one of the older, more recognized cities in the entire United States, it has deliberate pentagrams in it.
Yeah.
And that is based on the design of D.C., with the head of many of these inverted pentagrams leading to the White House or a major monument.
Hmm.
Yeah. Now, nobody's debunked that theory yet.
No, they did it on purpose. It's part of Freemasonry. Because in Freemasonry and a lot of places, you know, pentagrams aren't necessarily an evil thing.
So is Outback Steakhouse a part of the Freemasonry group?
Maybe. But there's, like, I'm looking at, like, post after post of people basically drawing pentagrams of all the Outback Steakhouses in their area.
Yeah.
We tried it here at Cheap Geek Podcast in New Mexico, and it makes sort of a sad stick.
Because there's only 4 Outback Steakhouses.
And they all sort of, like, fall in line. So you can go from one to the next to the next to the next. It's kind of a sad, wiggly stick.
Which is weird, because in the entire state, you have 2 Outback Steakhouses that are literally down the road from each other.
Yep.
And then the next closest one is at the very bottom of Albuquerque.
Yeah.
And then all the way in Santa Fe, and there are no other ones.
Yep. Just, what, 3 or 4?
This is the
sad stick.
This is the 4th or 5th largest state in the United States, and there's only 4 Outback Steakhouses.
Yeah. Well, that's because I think New Mexico hates Australians.
That's not fair. No, why? Is it because we're in competition over poisonous animals?
Maybe. Who knows? But it is kind of weird, because I was going through looking at all those Twitter posts where people have been posting pictures and stuff the same way. Well, they've gone through and they've taken a look and they've sort of mapped it out. And there's a lot of them, man. So it might purely be coincidental, or just maybe the way the traffic is sort of designed with all the streets and signs and, you know, all the traffic, you know, sort of layouts there. I don't know. I just thought that was kind of strange to be able to, you know, draw pentagrams everywhere. I mean, they weren't exactly perfect, you know, but maybe it really is a conspiracy. Maybe Outback is trying to do something. Who knows? But the Bloomin' Onion is very, very tasty, by the way.
We haven't eaten there in a while.
Yeah, it's been a while. I think the last time we had an Outback was in Texas.
Oh, No, that was an Applebee's.
That was an Applebee's in Texas. We were in Louisiana. We were somewhere. We were somewhere in the 8 states we traveled over in 7 days. Maybe it was Mississippi.
No. In fact, we kind of tried to blow through there.
Okay, well, where was it then?
I don't remember. I don't think we ate an Outback through the United States.
Yeah, we did.
Huh. Wait, was it in Carolina with your brother?
No.
Okay, all right. I don't know. I miss the Bloomin' Onion, and I really want some of their weird bread. So
Black bread?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, now I really want some of that.
Very nice.
I have no idea where we stopped at.
I don't remember.
Gosh. All right. I know it wasn't in Roswell, because there isn't one in Roswell.
Nope. There is not.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, that's something to think about.
Ooh.
So, yeah, there you go. That was some pretty interesting things. It could be coincidental. I don't know.
Yeah.
So it's kind of neat how we go from talking about artificial intelligence, inner space stuff, you know, like the last two podcasts, and then to satanic Outback Steakhouses. So if you have something like that you'd like us to talk about and you want to give us a call, we actually have a number you can dial. It's a real phone number.
Yeah.
It's 575-208-4025. Roswell area code.
Mm-hmm.
Little secret, though, we're not in Roswell.
Shh.
We're broadcasting from the dirt in New Mexico. I should do something like that. You know, we got to figure out some kind of like theme music or something like that. Maybe we'll do this one.
No.
It's not good enough. That doesn't work at all.
No.
Broadcasting from the dirt. No, I don't like that. I bet this one. No.
No.
I figure out something. Yes. So anyway, there you go. Give us a call. 575-208-4025. If you have any comments, suggestions, concerns, or things you'd like to, suggest to us to talk about, we'd be more than happy to take a, you know, not saying we are going to talk about whatever you send in, but, you know, ideas are welcomed.
Huh.
So, what was that for? You're like, what?
No, I was just looking at your next article.
Which is my next article. I know exactly what it is.
Bizarre alien boy with a weird elongated skull found in a Crimean tomb.
Big head alien boy.
Yes.
Yeah. So this was kind of weird. I took a look at this and was like, what? And what made it even more weird is the fact that this little alien boy, big headed alien boy, what is it? Big, got myself worked up.
The
alien boy with
skull.
The big elongated head, right?
Yeah.
That they found in the Crimean tomb.
Mm-hmm.
Is not an alien at all, but he's a member of a mysterious warrior race, and I was even more excited than that, you know, to go, what?
Yeah.
Yeah, so
well, see, my
there's
thing
a terrestrial
was,
explanation.
I saw the photo before I read the article.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this isn't an alien. This is one of those ancient Mayan or Incan people where they used to strap the baby's head to the board to make the skull longer. And then I read, oh, wait, no, this is like in Russia or something.
Yeah.
They didn't do that in Russia.
What they did was, and these are archaeologists, they found something, a burial site in Crimea, right?
Yeah.
And it's close to the giant $2.9 billion bridge currently being built by Vladimir Putin to connect the peninsula to mainland Russia. So it's sort of an annexed area. They immediately called it an alien grave because of the big head skeleton, right?
Yeah.
And this is one Russian state media outlet reported that there are some adherents to ancient astronauts.
Okay.
And they kind of keep going with it. And so what they found is that that's not necessarily the case at all.
Hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
The theory is that owners of such elongated skulls may be human extraterrestrial hybrids, and that's not necessarily the case. But what they think is it's actually a member of a sort of mysterious warrior class.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. What kind of warriors?
I don't know.
Oh. That's weird. Okay. Near the skeleton, there was a vessel made of clay with some tiny beads. The boy's arm, there was a copper bracelet around it.
Yep.
True warriors. So the artificially elongated skull was a sign of a true warrior, and the deformation process was practiced in a number of other ancient cultures.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, what's the name of them?
Samaritans? Samartians?
Sarmatians, I guess.
Sarmatians, yeah.
Yeah.
They basically held sway in that region around 2,000 years ago, and they were famed for their female warriors who helped conquer the Crimea in ancient times.
Huh, so maybe the female warriors strapped the babies to a board and fought people.
Maybe. It says the prominent role of the group of women in warfare was seen as an inspiration to the Amazons.
Oh.
So, yeah, they don't necessarily think that it's alien anymore. It's just, you know, big-headed warriors.
So we're I'm trying to Google where the heck is Crimea. So I'm trying to.
I think it's part of the Ukraine.
It's a peninsula in Europe.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so it's in the Black Sea. And that makes sense. You know, yep. From the Black Sea all the way to Greece, I could see the theory of the Amazons.
It was kind of crazy. There are pictures, of course, and this is from the Sun UK.
Yeah.
And we'll have links to all that stuff in the show notes. You can kind of take a look and see. But when I seen it, I was like, no way. I kind of like the idea that this is part of a warrior race, mysterious warrior race.
I think that's...
Who's inspired by the Amazons.
Far cooler than aliens. Yeah. So...
Crazy.
But...
I like how the scientists are like, oh, alien grave.
Yeah.
And it's the first thing they jump on.
Oh, man. What if this is...
If you look in it, one of the pictures, is like a horse... That was buried there.
Yeah, that's kind of sad, though, because you see the horse, you see another open grave to the far left.
Yeah.
Experts
believe that the change in the shape of the skull influenced a person's character with the intention of making them a more aggressive fighter.
Hmm.
So, there
probably because people making fun of their forehead.
Maybe. You've got a big, tall head. You have to wear a big, tall hat.
Tall helmet. Yeah. Oh, man.
So, it's just kind of crazy looking. But, I mean, why would they, that's the thing, though, why would they even do that? Like, if you want to make somebody more an aggressive fighter, you know, I don't understand why making their heads bigger, that would actually do something, unless they had some sort of frame of reference.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, okay, it's a couple thousand years ago, which I'm assuming that most, you could be probably easily swayed or influenced, so why would they look at somebody with a big, tall head and go, that person,
Gorillas and orangutans, they have really big foreheads.
Yeah, but in the Crimea and the Black Sea, I don't think they're going to find too many primates out that way.
Oh,
it's
kind of
cold, man. So who, I don't know, maybe, it's kind of hard to say. What did they actually see that made them think that was a way to fight? Maybe there were some big-headed dudes out there. Big, tall heads.
You mean aliens?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Or something.
Okay.
But I thought it was kind of strange. I was like, what? Huh. So there you go. Instead of being an actual baby alien, big-head alien baby boy. It's more of a mysterious warrior race with the elongated skull. So they think that maybe the skeleton was from a warrior in training, I guess. So evidently they started young.
Yeah.
And it looks like this poor fella, for whatever reason, didn't make it.
Okay.
Yep. So there you go. That's about all the stuff I want to talk about today.
Really?
Yeah, okay. As far as news articles go. If you're looking for stuff to binge watch, we have a list here, and you can find it in our show notes where we talk about Glow, which I still like that, Missing 411, which will make you angry, Midnight Texas, which is a show that's coming on NBC, two episodes in, maybe it'll get better, we'll see.
Yeah.
Preacher's still pretty cool, season 2, waiting for that to start showing back up again on the old Hulu, and fun fact, it's filmed in New Mexico, which is why we kind of like it, I guess.
So isn't Midnight filmed in New Mexico, too?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Both of them.
Yeah.
And do you have some binge-worthy tech?
Yes. So normally we talk about things that are either worthwhile or save you money. And everybody has a smartphone, and a lot of people have kids, or a lot of people just like to play games on their phone. My biggest complaint about playing games on your phone is even the free ones, they still find a way to make you pay.
That's true.
Now, this is a very simple, very kidsy game, but I haven't had to pay at all for it. And that is Pokemon's Magikarp Jump. If you like Pokemon, you know about Magikarp. It's that useless Pokemon that doesn't do anything until you evolve it. Well, this game is centered around this Magikarp and competing with it. So you basically play, you build your character up, and then it competes. The cool thing is, though, it's cute, it's animated, and you don't have to pay. You can get very far in the game without having to pay. And I'm one of those people that loves smartphone games, but I'm terrible at them. Like, Candy Crush, I was already whooping out $2 or $3 by, like, level 20. Because I'm just that bad at it. And this one, I got all the way to, well, before I changed phones, I think I already got to like level 40.
Wow.
Yeah. So if you want a free game and you don't have to worry about, oh, that's another thing. In order to buy stuff, you really do have to reach around your own elbow to make an actual purchase.
Yeah.
They kind of designed that for the benefit of the parents. So if you want a game for your kids to play or yourself, check this thing out. It's on Google Play. It's also on iTunes. So, you know, check it out. It's probably a fun game for kids, too. I just like it because I get to fish up characters and they're little fishes and they live in a pond.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I thought it was worthwhile. No paying. Already, like, level 40.
Dang.
Yeah. So, I don't know. And when I find little apps like that, I think other people should check them out, too.
Very nice.
Yep. Anything else?
Nope.
Oh, okay. Well, then be sure to check us out on YouTube and the Instagrams.
And our Facebook page.
Yep.
You can join the CheapGeek Facebook group.
Or the CheapGeek fan page.
Yes.
Yes. Follow us there.
And if you're looking for music for your podcast or project or something like that, you can go to incompetech.com, which is Kevin McLeod's website, and he has music there that you can use with the understanding that you're using it under the Creative Commons by Attribution 3.0 license. So we do appreciate that, and you can also download and buy his music while you're there. And I think it's pretty good to have a resource like that. There's lots of resources out there, but you know, that's the one that we like to use. So other than that, it's really about all I got. So, yeah. You got anything?
Nope. Just if anybody wants to comment on the show or send us a message, podcast@cheapgeek.net.
Very nice. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that was episode number 46 of the Cheap Geek Podcast. Thank you very much for listening. See you later. Take it easy. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Peanut butter, I like peanut butter, peanut butter, I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter, I like peanut butter, peanut butter, I like peanut butter.